Merci beaucoup, cher Nora. Dear members of the Standing Committee, Member State Representatives, colleagues and friends, I would like to thank you for joining today. Not at least the colleagues who are physically in the room here, so giving really a sense of normality. And first and foremost, I would like to take you through still some huge challenges, some emergency threats we are facing in the region, but with a sense of optimism, as I see that we are constantly learning from current and past challenges. So, we are facing multiple complex emergencies still. The COVID-19, first and foremost. As we are telling, we are still not out of the pandemic. But as we enter the summer, as in 2020 and 2021, the COVID-19 trends are going in the right direction. And we see this in the number of hospitalizations and deaths, which continue to decrease. But we already have also a couple of signals that suggest that the autumn of 2022 will be similar to the two preceding years, meaning another resurgence. One of the signals is the increasing prevalence of the BA4 and BA5 sublineage of Omicron in Portugal, Spain and other countries. WHO Europe is now looking at how the summer travel will contribute to extending the spread of this variant across the region. And to prepare systems and communities for the end of the year, next month we will be issuing a so-called autumn strategy for COVID-19, addressing strategies for surveillance, vaccination, public health and social measures, health service maintenance, the so-called dual track, and risk communication. So trying to learn the lessons that societies will not have to resort again to this very, very tightening, strict measures. The war in Ukraine is still with us, unfortunately. And as many of you know, I have been paying 3 visits this year already to Ukraine during the war, and I'm planning for a 4th one, a 3rd during the war before the summer, together with Minister of Health Viktor Lashko. WHO has prepared, together with the Minister of Health, a program document outlining 5 principles for approaching the recovery and transformation of Ukraine's health system. And it's amazing, when I went to Ukraine, how the government is trying to merge the acute humanitarian assistance program with already thinking longer term on the recovery of the health system. Here I would like to express appreciation to the Minister of Health of Poland, Minister Adam Niedzielski, for inviting me and a number of ministers of health in the European region the 22nd of June to one of the major economic events at the level of the head of state in Poland on a session on the recovery of the health system of Ukraine, which will happen the 22nd of June. Another emergency still being faced are polio outbreaks in Tajikistan, Ukraine and Israel. And here I would like to point out the success story in Tajikistan, because sometimes I have the impression that we do not celebrate enough also the successes. And I would like to commend really the government, the whole of government, the Minister of Health of Tajikistan, for really successfully responding to the outbreak of the polio, and also commending our own team. And this despite of the COVID-19 surge. I remember at the beginning that we were all very, very anxious that the situation in Tajikistan could lead to the whole region losing its polio-free status, but the outbreak was declared closed on the 29th April of 2022. On the monkeypox, as of the 5th of June, there have been around 800 confirmed cases in 21 countries in the European region. The initial cases were presented in men who have sex with men, but we must remember that monkeypox is caused by a virus that can affect anyone and thus is not intrinsically associated with any specific group of people. And in fact, here I would like to say that the gay and the bisexual communities, we have seen, have high awareness and rapid health-seeking behavior when it comes to their and their communities' sexual health. And we should applaud them for their early presentation to healthcare services and at all cost really avoid any stigma and discrimination. On the hepatitis, as of the 31st of May 2022, there were 305 cases of hepatitis of unknown etiology in children, which, as you know, have been reported from multiple countries worldwide. It is not clear yet whether all cases identified following the alert are part of a true increase compared to the baseline rate of hepatitis of unknown etiology in children. Of 131 cases for which this information was available, 14 or 10%, 1 out of 10, have received a liver transplant. And unfortunately, there has been one death associated with this disease. The etiology and the pathogenic mechanisms of disease are still under investigation. A possible association with current adenovirus infection has been identified, but other hypotheses and possible cofactors are under investigation. So we have to hold the fort on many fronts at the same time. All of you are aware that there was a special session last month on the war in Ukraine, and we will come back to this a little later. On the governance, after our last virtual meeting of the SERC in December, the members of the 29th SERC met again for the first time in person in Bern, hosted by our chair. And thank you again, Nora. This was also psychologically, you know, for ourselves, a very important event, that physically we came back in a wonderful environment and that you created, Nora, with the colleagues. And with Nora and all of you, the SERC, we had decided that that meeting would be rather a kind of a retreat, a brainstorming on a number of issues, including on the follow-up on the report of the Pan-European Commission on Health and Sustainable Development, but also on further to improve the governance and how the European governance can contribute to the global governance. And I hope that the SERC members agree with me that it was very productive and some ideas were already mentioned at the executive board. Strengthening health leadership is a core goal of the EPW, and I myself undertook 19 missions to 17 countries since the last report of the SERC. I would like to reassure you that for each mission we have at least one session with the directors before I go, looking at the data and brainstorming on the 2-3 very concrete outputs, because WHO had a little bit here in the reputation in the past, yes, there is a high-level mission and then a nice picture at a high level, and then so what? We put a lot of effort in preparing this. I will not go in detail, but for each of the missions, we can inform you what are the 2-3 very concrete outputs. Here is a picture of the president of Moldova, and I would like to commend really President Maia for her leadership, also towards universal health coverage, towards receiving per capita the biggest number also of Ukrainian refugees, despite of the tremendous financial pressure it is putting on the Moldovan health system, because the other neighboring countries are EU countries which more easily benefit from support mechanism. And as I had committed to the president, Madam President, on each occasion I will appeal to the international community to really support Moldova, and particularly through budget support. Next slide, please. First pillar of the EPW, moving towards universal health coverage. I am tremendously indebted to the government of Greece for the inauguration of the WHO Athens Office on Quality of Care and Patient Safety happened in March together with Prime Minister Mitsotakis. This, and we're very proud of this, was the first public event of Prime Minister Mitsotakis since he came out of isolation due to having COVID-19 himself. And he was telling me, Hans, can you imagine how many competing events there were for his first public appearance? But to demonstrate his commitment to health, to collaboration with the WHO European Office of Europe, the first event was the opening of the Quality of Care. And thank you also to the Minister of Health, Pleuvris. Actually, the opening, I remember we were with the Prime Minister and three ministers, one assistant minister, one deputy minister, including two previous ministers. So now this program is really already up and running. Health and migration. Several of you colleagues were present in March. In fact, we had 31 ministers, refugee and migrant representatives, delegates from over 50 countries of three regions, the European, Eastern Mediterranean and African regions, UN agencies, and my two fellow region directors, Dr. Moeti from AFRO and Dr. Ahmed Al-Mandari from EMRO, and international partners coming together in Istanbul to work together, agree together on the new vision on health and migration. President Erdogan himself was opening the meeting, and I would like to take the opportunity to really thank Dr. Koca, the Minister of Health of Turkey, and President Erdogan for this very significant meeting. You know, we support really inter-region collaboration, and one of the outcomes was that we move from the narrative migration is something, a crisis, is something acute, to a fundamental part and phenomenon of our society, moving from a burden to a opportunity. And then we moved from Istanbul to the World Health Assembly on the Tuesday of the World Health Assembly. And again, several of you were present, thank you, on a side event in Hotel Intercontinental in Geneva to take it to the global level. And again, we had three RDs over there, and Dr. Ahmed Al-Mandari already committed to continue and host a follow-up in his region. Colleagues, I will not go through everything. We have the presentation available, but I would like to point out definitely the Oslo Medicines Initiative and express appreciation particularly to Dr. Bjørn Inge Larsen and the new Secretary General that I had the opportunity to meet of Norway. And we came, after some creative brainstormings, to an agreement how to take it forward, because the Oslo Medicines Initiative has been also suffering from the consequences of the war in Ukraine, in the sense that for Norway it is not possible to invite all 53 countries due to the policy. And how we came out of it is that we will move the meeting which was planned mid-June in Oslo to the regional committee, because the Western countries are able to meet with all 53 countries either under the World Health Assembly or under the umbrella of the regional committee. So basically we will condense the Oslo meeting into a very important ministerial lunch the first day of the RC72, the Monday, which will expand to have together the member state representatives, the European Federation of International Pharmaceutical Associations, and also IFPMA, the International Federation, with patients and physician representatives, the insurers, together to discuss and hopefully agree on the statement that we will circulate on moving towards a roadmap to ensure sustainable, equal access to innovative, high-priced medicines. And I would like to commend here our colleagues from Norway for their flexibility, because this is not just a meeting. There has been a lot of technical webinars, a lot of very good documents, so we have to safeguard that meeting. Then at the RC, this will be kind of the high end of the joint branding of the Oslo Medicines Initiative, after which we will take it forward under the WHO umbrella. For this, colleagues, I appeal to all of you to really have your ministers. because that Norway made very clear, and I fully support the same position, that this has to be at a ministerial level. Then health system financing is more than ever into the focus, because we have to work very hard to safeguard the same level, at least, if not more, of public health spending in the wake of inflation and the economic turmoil, where obviously a lot of finance goes to defense. The Barcelona Office for Health System Financing is providing support to more than 20 member states by presenting the evidence to support the right political choices in these difficult financial, economic and political times. Here I'm very grateful to the past chair of the Pan-European Commission, Professor Mario Monti, because the commission is finished, but Professor Monti kindly agreed to continue to work with us as the special envoy on health, finance and sustainable development. Professor Monti has a whole work program, including attending regularly the OECD meetings, other meetings with finance decision makers to continue to advocate for investment in health and sustainable development, creating the necessary fiscal space through efficiency gains and reprioritizing of the budgets. Pillar number two, protecting against health emergency, pillar two of GPW and the EPW. We are working very hard, and Dr. Gerald Rockenshaw is the focal point there, our director of emergencies, but it's through whole of office approach, and we'll come to you on what we call preparedness 2.0, which we'd like to present in a draft at a session Tuesday morning at the RC. Because the question is, if there's a pandemic, are we better prepared or not, despite of all the meetings? Let me share a couple of points which came out so far of internal brainstorming on preparedness 2.0. Number one, the need to increase public health funding. And that's what we're working on within the Monti Commission. Number two, protect nature. Because we know that most of the infectious diseases are zoonotic infections. So, one health. Number three, act early and quickly. Remember, even if WHO, Dr. Tedros, announced the pandemic, still it took 4 to 6 weeks in many countries to act upon it. And here the pan-European CDC comes into play. Number four, to work more on public health communication. I think we all got our bruises on communicating. Some good lessons, but also some painful lessons. Number five, fight misinformation. And number six, support your own health. Support your own health, because we know in the better shape you are, the more you're going to get through these calamities. For example, obese people, people with other diseases, were really targeted first. That's also why I ask Willy's team, for me, for example, to table fish instead of meat this evening. We have to support our own health. Then, on the AMR. We are very proud that for the first time, we published the antimicrobial resistance surveillance report in Europe together with the ECDC, European Center for Disease Prevention and Control. And I really want to commend here Andrea Amund, my great counterpart of ECDC, because we were trying this for quite a while, we postponed a bit of COVID-19, but we got there. And as a follow-up already, we had a workshop for European Union member states on AMR National Action Plan Development and Implementation together with the European Commission, and no planning for the non-EU member states. But we are ready to move the AMR work to a whole new level, which is one of the big messages I took away from the World Health Assembly. So we know this, and we are committed to do this. Third pillar of GPW and EPW is on promoting health and well-being. Just a couple of points. Signature initiative on alcohol taxation. Here, I would like to comment the Baltic states, the three Baltic states, Lithuania, Latvia and Estonia. We launched the WHO Euro Signature Initiative on Alcohol Taxation the 23rd of February. Really, Baltic States very, very committed. And meanwhile, we have a first modeling study by the working group to inform decision makers about the current level of alcohol taxation in the region, the whole region, and the potential health gains that can be achieved through increasing the level of tax, similar to the existing minimum level for tobacco taxes. What did it reveal? If countries of the WHO European region were to introduce a minimum level of 15% tax on the retail price per unit of alcohol, regardless of the type of alcoholic beverage, it would save 133,000 lives each year. On International Childhood Cancer Day, the 15th of February 2022, WHO Europe launched the report on childhood cancer inequalities in the region. For the first time, we have a report providing evidence on childhood cancer inequalities in the region, examining the patterns that emerge at national and regional levels of childhood cancer incidents, patient and caregiver experiences, and short and long-term outcomes for patients, with concrete recommendations to help decision makers. And here I would like to commend also our WHO Europe Cancer Ambassador Aaron Andersen for his continued strong support. We also kicked off the first joint project with the World Diabetes Foundation. We are very, very proud of this. We tried for quite a while. We even had a meeting with the CEO of the World Diabetes Foundation here in Copenhagen. And this project is in Kyrgyzstan and Uzbekistan through primary healthcare. It will be a major step forward in diabetes care. We also launched the first WHO European regional obesity report. Actually, I saw it's on the first website also page of the International Cancer Center in Lyon, because it's very, very innovative globally. 95% of the adults and almost one in three children are overweight or living of obesity. These figures are really daunting, and the report also makes a number of recommendations. It's what we call a wicked problem. It has to be tackled from all sides, including environmental and commercial determinants of poor diet. And there are new climate change country profiles showing the key health risk for action in the European region. And here I would like to commend the colleagues working with us under the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change. EPW flagship initiatives. I think we have a later slide on showing the developments on the mental health, but I believe that the mental health movement really starts to kick off, and it went very important from region level to national level. To give one example, Armenia. I was there recently. The Minister of Health of Armenia is taking forward the national coalition on mental health, involving all the stakeholders in society, public and private sector. Digital health is one of the flagships, and we're focusing also on at the country level, for example, assessment report in Azerbaijan, as well as a scoping mission to Sweden, then the Western Balkan roadmap. So again, trying bottom-up approach. Once that we present the region action plan, that it is fed by a lot of country work, which is the same for the European immunization agenda, again highlighting the success story in Tajikistan, is not to be underestimated. And there is also a partnership with non-traditional stakeholders now up and running, including the youth, to ensure that inequity is being addressed. Behavior and culture insights will be presented, I believe, later on, but new guidance was published on setting up units in countries. Then we're engaging in training programs, case-based training program on BCI, and many more works are being taken forward, including, for example, postpartum depression project in Romania and Denmark. But Rob will go a little bit more in details. We are developing now a roadmap for each of those flagships. We will have a retreat of the directors pre-summer on Friday, and their directors will present their roadmaps. This shows you the road we have been going together since the first meeting of the Mental Health Coalition. 6 work packages are set out. Mental health leadership, mental health service transformation, with a particular focus on mental health of the workforce. This came in each discussion of my bilaterals with the minister during the World Health Assembly, including at the ministerial summit in Budva, Montenegro, last week, the mental health of the workforce. Support mental health in emergencies, mental health for children and adolescents, mental health in the workplace, which you're doing very closely with WHO headquarters, with Deborah, and mental health of the elderly. And here I would like to thank Denmark, Dr. Søren Brøstrøm, for a great event at the World Health Assembly globally on mental health. The approach is to support countries through a sub-regional way of working, and for this purpose, a series of meetings are planned with different country groupings. It's a flywheel which is really kicking off, and also very close to the European Commission. We get support also from DG Santé, and I want to commend here the Commissioner Stella Kyriakides, because this is a very example where the two organizations are putting their comparative advantages together to avoid duplication and move faster. I would like to thank Belgium also. I had a very inspiring meeting a week ago, maybe you saw from my social media, where I had the honor to introduce the Queen of Belgium, Queen Mathilde, to the First Lady, Madame Zelenska of Ukraine, to carry forward the mental health pan-European. And I should say that these two great ladies are really making history in mental health. In the flagship of the flagships, as you know, is primary healthcare. That will be also a key in my TED talk at the Region Committee 72. What we're doing is harnessing the momentum as countries revitalize their PHC services, examining both strengths and weaknesses in the wake of COVID-19. The support to countries has never been more in demand. In the past 6 months alone, we have provided tailored assistance to 20 countries and engaging intensively in 8 of them. So country work, but at the same time, a number of regional products where we aim to create high quality evidence for PHC reform, and we connect countries for mutual learning. Here I would like to point out that together with the Minister of Health of Kazakhstan, Dr. Azar Giniat, we launched the first WHO PHC demonstration platform in Kazakhstan, and not in a city, but in a region, in Isik. The idea is that we will have 4 PHC demonstration platform projects where countries can learn how do you put concrete the Alma-Ata and Astana declaration into practice. The first is in Kazakhstan. Congratulations, Kazakhstan. Second will be in rural Sweden. Third one in Spain. Fourth one, and thank you, Spain, for this. Fourth one in Slovenia. So that according to different sub-regions, we have very, very pragmatic demonstration platform. A modus operandi, as you know very well, is to work sub-regionally, regionally and sub-regionally in particularly. We had an awesome ministerial summit in Budva in Montenegro. Really, minister also, new minister of mental health of Montenegro, we got the opportunity, Dr. Cekic and me, to get to know each other. And thank you, Mariana, for fantastic hosting. Right. And we had what we wanted to do, a very frank exchange. Actually, we had the top level, deputy prime ministers, minister of health. And the agenda was, number one, how to protect public health spending. We had the minister of finance, minister of economy and tourism of Montenegro. We discussed about new governance in the wake of the pandemic. And I want to thank the colleagues of the European Observatory, Joseph Figueras, Matthias, John Silas, for joining us and doing great, great work. The workforce, no surprise, a big one. Particularly nurses, we have to do a lot of work there, a lot of work. And the fourth one was very innovative, was together with the World Tourism Organization and OECD and European Commission on healthy and sustainable tourism. In 2020 alone, the international tourist decreased with 70%. For a number of those countries, this was almost mortal. So we looked, no health without healthy tourism. It means quality of care, of emergency medical services and primary healthcare. And we have a great policy brief on that one. The roadmap in the Western Balkans is proceeding very well. And now the roadmap for health in Central Asia is really gaining traction. I would like to thank Turkmenistan here, the permanent representative to the UN in Geneva, hosted the Sunday morning of the WHA, a meeting for the 5 minutes of health on the roadmap for health in Central Asia. We have a plan to have a plan, including to launch it ultimately at the level of the head of states. Non-governmental organizations, next point, remains very important, and I will go to the next slide because of timing. I'm running out of time, for which I apologize. WHO Europe fit for purpose. Remember, I gave 3 commitments when I became the regional director to all of you, administratively, I mean. Number 1, transparency. Number 2, accountability. And number 3, to live within my means, which is still a very big challenge. I was very vocal on that one at the last RC, that I inherited a huge financial deficit. We mobilized quite some funding, but this is not sustainable because of COVID-19. Tomorrow, I will present to you where are we. I want very transparent with the offshoring of enabling functions outside of Copenhagen. We do this very participatory. We had a working group of the staff association, who came up with 5 locations. I spoke to the heads of delegation of all 5 countries, and I have sent a formal letter to the Minister of Foreign Affairs to all of those countries, and very welcome to provide any comments on that one tomorrow. The Pan-European Leadership Academy is really a flywheel which has gained traction, and I'm very proud of this, despite of the COVID-19. We have 8 future health leaders from the Russian Federation, Bosnia-Herzegovina, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Turkmenistan, who recently completed their first placements in Copenhagen and now are placed in technical units and at the country level. And you see them on the slide here. And now we have plans finalized for the rollout of Tier 2. Tier 2 aims at mid-career professionals in the Ministry of Health and Institutes of Public Health to come for 3 months for an exchange to really strengthen public health leadership. And I want to thank the president of the European Forum of Health of Gastein, Dr. Clemens Oder, for connecting and kindly allowing that all of the Tier 1 young leaders will be welcome in Gastein as well as Tier 2. I think it's very symbolically. And Dr. Clemens Oder and me agreed at the World Health Assembly to join efforts for the 25th anniversary of the European Health Forum in Gastein, which will be really great, and I also encourage everyone to be present. We are very committed, colleagues, as you know, to preventing and responding to sexual exploitation, abuse and harassment. We will tell a little bit more about that one. We go hand in hand with the global action plan, but at the same time, we're not waiting. We're very proactive. Since last autumn, we moved quickly to put in place short-term initiatives, including in the context of the war in Ukraine, where we have to recruit a lot of people very fast, very quickly, on different kinds of contracts. But we have deployed 5 personnel already to address this, and we do it also with partner agencies. We are putting in that regard a lot of attention to the voices of women-led organizations and community organizations that support women and girls in Euro to have their voice heard in the strategy development process. I think this is the last slide on looking ahead. COVID-19, to be a step ahead this time, to have an autumn strategy. The monkeypox, we are following very, very closely. The Ukraine response and recovery remains very important. I want to thank Minister Viktor Lashko for our joint commitment. In fact, we agreed that before the summer, we may go to Odessa this time. Then inter-regional cooperation remains very strong. I strongly believe that the future of WHO hinges a lot on inter-regional collaboration. I want to thank Dr. Carissa Etienne and Dr. Takeshi for going to be present at the Regional Committee 72 virtually through a message. The first week of August, I will go on my second mission to the United States of America. I had a great, great talk during the WHA at the embassy at the top level, and to sign tripartite agreement with Dr. Carissa Etienne and HHS, because we are the two epicenters, really, of the pandemic. And thank you also to Dr. Takeshi of WIPRO for welcoming me to go to China, Japan, South Korea, will be the first week of February, and then have a retreat between our directors, because we have a lot to learn on digital health from that region. Preparation for RC72, again, I want to thank Nora for continued support there, not at least on the agenda also, and Israel. Israel is really getting ready for a fantastic RC72, where we need all of you and your ministers. And Rob is going to say something more later on the accountability compact that I would like to present to you later on. Because as of today, we are realizing that actually there is no really accountability compact between the WHO Regional Office for Europe and the Regional Director and the Member States, really. That we don't get into the same situation that in a couple of years, Member States are very surprised, for example, that there is a financial deficit or there are other some big problems. What are the number one, three big procurements being done in this office? Right? What is the big funding being spent on? So we would like to come to a kind of accountability compact, which is mutual accountability. That if I am not able to report, to implement, that maybe I need more support from the member states. That we hold each other accountable is quite innovative, and we're very excited. And finally, we will have end of June. I'm surprised now how quick it will come. The senior leadership retreat with all the WHO representatives and our senior management to really agree and discuss how do we move forward now and work differently since the COVID-19 pandemic and the other emergencies we have in the region, and really get back to business as usual to scale up the public health work. Know that at the RC I will be facing the midterm already of my first mandate. Thank you so much, dear Nora, for allowing me the time, and over to you.